So let's say I have a piece of mRNA. And this mRNA was transcribed or copied from a piece of DNA, and it's holding information. And let's say that each one of these rectangles on our mRNA is one nucleotide. So every three nucleotides, or every group of three nucleotides, is going to code for one amino acid. So three nucleotides, or one codon, a codon is simply three nucleotides, code for one amino acid. And what we want to do is we want to read this piece of mRNA and put together all the amino acids that it codes for in the precise order that they're coded for to make a polypeptide. So polypeptide is a chain of amino acids strung together. And then we want to take this polypeptide and fold it into all sorts of interesting shapes to make a protein. And some proteins actually have more than one polypeptide chain, like the protein hemoglobin, for example. So hemoglobin is a protein in our blood that helps us carry oxygen, and it's made up of four polypeptide chains that are folded in a very precise shape or conformation. So the question is, how do we get from this piece of mRNA to the polypeptide that we want? In other words, how do we read this piece of mRNA? And the answer to that question is through a process known as protein translation. And protein translation happens in an organelle in the cell called the ribosome, which is the picture that you're seeing right in the middle. And so let's recap. So protein translation is the process by which we're going to take a piece of mRNA and we're going to run it through the ribosome. And then the ribosome is going to put together the corresponding chain of amino acids known as a polypeptide. And where are these ribosomes found? So ribosomes are found in the cytoplasm of the cell. And they're also found in a different organelle called the endoplasmic reticulum. And there are two types of endoplasmic reticulum. There's the smooth endoplasmic reticulum and the rough endoplasmic reticulum. And ribosomes are found in the rough endoplasmic reticulum. And so by looking at this picture, you can see that the ribosome is made up of two units, a larger one and a smaller one. And here we get into some differences between eukaryotic cells and prokaryotic cells. So let's make a quick chart. We have eukaryotic cells and prokaryotic cells. And in eukaryotic cells, the larger subunit is 60S. It's kind of a way to measure it, and in a minute we'll get to what that S stands for. And the smaller unit is 40S, but if the two units are together, combined, they are 80S. And in prokaryotic cells, the larger unit is 50S, the smaller unit is 30S, but if we combine them together, they are 70S. And you're probably thinking that I'm really bad at math because 60 plus 40 is not 80, and 50 plus 30 is not 70. So to clarify that, let's talk about what this S is. So the S stands for a unit of measurement called the Svedberg. And the Svedberg measures the rate of sedimentation of the ribosomes. So let's explain what that is. So if I were to take a test tube, and if I put some ribosomes into this test tube, some big ones, some little ones, some larger subunits, some smaller ones, some of them are combined large and small subunits. And if I were to take this test tube, and of course the ribosomes are suspended in some sort of liquid. And so if I were to take this test tube and spin it down in a centrifuge, these ribosomes would all fall down to the bottom, settle at the bottom of the tube at different rates. And so the Svedberg measures the rate at which the ribosomes will fall to the bottom of the test tube. And because the Svedberg does not necessarily measure size, the numbers are not additive. they don't necessarily add up. So the next thing I want to ask you is, so the ribosome is putting together its polypeptide, you know, he's stringing together the amino acids, but where are the amino acids coming from? Like, where are they? And the answer to that question is that floating around in the cytoplasm and in the endoplasmic reticulum, we have these molecules called tRNA, and they hold on to amino acids and bring the amino acids to the ribosome. So let's see what a tRNA molecule looks like. And I'm just going to get rid of some of this RNA that's coming out of the ribosome. And here's our tRNA molecule. And I did not draw this to scale, so a tRNA molecule is really much smaller than the ribosome. So it has this clover-like shape, and in real life it's actually a 3D structure. So we know it's made up of RNA. So what does that T stand for? That T stands for the word transfer. So this is transfer RNA, and the reason it's called transfer RNA is because its job is literally to transfer amino acids to the ribosome. So it's kind of like a mailman. It holds on to this package, the amino acid, and its job is to bring the package or amino acid to the proper address, which is the ribosome, or more specifically, a particular place on the mRNA that's in the ribosome, but we're not going to get into that in such great detail right now. So let's focus on this tRNA molecule. And I want to look at one particular place on the tRNA molecule. This part right over here. I'm just going to make some room. And I picked that part because there are, if you could see between the two yellow lines, there are three nucleotides there. I want to blow up those three nucleotides. And let's say that these three nucleotides are G, G, and G. And so the codon that's complementary to GGG is CCC. And the codon CCC happens to code for the amino acid proline. And so this particular tRNA molecule is going to carry the amino acid proline right over here. And it happens to be that the bond between the amino acid and this tRNA molecule is a very high energy bond. It's relatively unstable, and just keep that in mind because we'll talk about that a little bit more later. Let's do this again so that we get a clear idea of what's going on. Let's say that the codon that we're looking at did not read GGG. Let's say it read UUU. And again, remember, we're focusing on this bit right over here. And so the codon that's complementary to UUU is AAA. And AAA codes for the amino acid lysine. And so this particular tRNA molecule is going to carry the amino acid lysine right over here. And so the part on the tRNA molecule, the part over here that determines which amino acid the tRNA molecule is going to hold, is called the anticodon. And then its complementary codon right over here is, well, just a codon. And just bear in mind that the anticodon and codon are complementary to each other. And try not to get confused. The tRNA molecule is not going to hold on to the amino acid that's coded for by the anticodon. So UUU happens to code for the amino acid phenylalanine. But this tRNA molecule does not carry phenylalanine. The tRNA molecule carries the amino acid that's coded for by the codon that's complementary to the anticodon. So in our case, the anticodon is UUU. The codon, the complementary codon is AAA. AAA codes for lysine. And so this particular tRNA molecule is going to carry the amino acid lysine.